Welcome, dear students, to this NIOS program on Fundamental Rights and Duties. I am your instructor, Dr. Victor Weber-Tandon. So, when we talk about fundamental rights and duties, what comes to your mind? What do you do when you are up against the power of the state? When your personal choices as an individual are not approved by the society, or when you're ostracized or discriminated against because of your choices, your gender, your religion, your caste, your status, or your sexual choices. When society imposes its will on you disregarding your choice, what remedy do you have? And what remedy do you have against a state, against a government that deprives you of your basic rights? What are these basic rights? And can the powerless, the marginalized, the weak of our society ever speak and be heard? What power do we have as citizens, as human beings, to ensure that we are treated in a humane manner and in a just manner? The answer lies in fundamental rights. And in this lecture, we are going to focus on what these rights are and what are our fundamental duties. Now, the objectives of today's discussion is, number one, to study the nature of fundamental rights, as I just told you, identify the safeguards against the deprivation of fundamental rights, examine the role of various constitutional freedoms, understand what is the freedom of religion, what are our cultural and educational rights, and to look at the various writs which are available under the Constitution for protection of our rights. We will also evaluate the limitations or the restrictions which are imposed on the enjoyment of our fundamental rights. Lastly, we are going to list our fundamental duties and examine their significance, as well as understand the relationship between our rights and duties. So, starting with fundamental rights, dear students, you have to understand that these fundamental rights are nothing but human rights. And these are of the nature of civil and political rights. They are essential for our holistic development as human beings, and they make our human life worth living. These rights are available to all human beings by virtue of the very fact that we are born as human beings. And these rights, some of these rights, are guaranteed to non-citizens also. Now, the concept of fundamental rights has been borrowed from the US Constitution. And US was one of the first countries to constitutionally recognize these rights. It was followed by Germany, which adopted fundamental rights in 1919, Ireland, which adopted these rights in 1922, and Russia, which adopted these rights in 1936. Now, for the protection of fundamental rights, there are special provisions in the sense that these rights are justiciable, which is a primary distinction between fundamental rights and directive principles of state policy. You can go to the court for violation of fundamental rights, but technically, theoretically, you can't go to the court for violation of your directive principles. Now, like all rights, these fundamental rights are not absolute. They come with several restrictions, which we are going to explore during the course of our lecture. Also, one very special feature about these fundamental rights is that both the Supreme Court and the state high courts, they have the power to protect this. As I said, these are justiciable rights. And how do these courts protect our fundamental rights? They protect it through writs. Also, another interesting point about our fundamental rights is that in the case of emergency, when there is a national emergency or financial emergency imposed in India, it is possible to suspend some of these fundamental rights, but not all. Moving on, by now you must have realized certain differences between fundamental rights and ordinary rights. One of the primary distinctions is that fundamental rights come from our constitution. These are the constitutional rights, and in that sense, they stand above ordinary rights. Ordinary rights can come from your statutes or from common law, but fundamental rights come from the Constitution. And because fundamental rights come from the Constitution, amending them is very difficult. So much so that some fundamental rights which are part of the basic structure of the Constitution, it is impossible to amend them. Whereas your ordinary rights can be amended, taken away, altered whenever the state or the government wants. Also, fundamental rights are of the nature of inalienable human rights. As I said in the beginning, these are civil and political rights which protect ordinary citizens against the power of the state. Ordinary rights are not inalienable human rights in the strict sense. They can arise from contract between parties, or they can come from certain laws. For example, your patent rights come from the Patents Act of India. Now, because they come from the Patent Act can be amended anytime by the state. So the primary point is that your ordinary rights are always a notch below the fundamental rights. Now, a question will come to your mind, how many fundamental rights do we have? Originally, in the Constitution, we had 7 fundamental rights. But by the 44th Constitutional Amendment, right to property was removed as a fundamental right, and now it merely exists as a constitutional right under Article 300A. These fundamental rights are present in Part 3 of our Constitution and are enshrined in Articles 14 to 32. And now they are classified in 6 broad categories. These are the right to equality, the fundamental freedoms, the right against exploitation, right to freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights, and lastly, the right to constitutional remedies. We are going to explore each one of these now. So coming to right to equality, the very first article is Article 14, which is available to all persons, whether they are citizens of India or not. And it says that the state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or the equal protection of all laws within the territory of India. In a sense, everybody, rich or poor, strong or not so mighty, everybody is equal before the law. There is Article 15 in this category, which says that there shall be no discrimination against any citizen on the grounds of their religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. But there are some exceptions to this, which we shall explore shortly. Now, because we cannot discriminate between citizens, it essentially means that all citizens can freely access shops, public restaurants, hotels, places of public entertainment, wells, tanks, bathing ghats, roads, and public resort places. Everything which is maintained out of state funds can be accessed equally by the citizens. There is no barrier to where a citizen or any person for that matter cannot go. But as I said, there is an important exception. The state can make special provision for, number one, the socially and economically backward classes, the SEBCs, and number two, for the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes. Because traditionally, these 3 categories of people, the SEBCs, the SCs, and the STs, have been discriminated against. So affirmative action is required for their upliftment, and the state can make special provision by law for the advancement of SEBCs, SCs, and STs relating to their admissions to educational institutions, whether these educational institutions are aided by the state or not. Now, on the similar lines, in matters of employment, we have Article 16. So while Article 15 said generally that you cannot discriminate amongst citizens and provided for affirmative action in the context of educational institutions, Article 16 talks about equal opportunity in matters of public employment or employment under the state for all citizens. Again, in terms of employment, the state cannot discriminate on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, descent, place of birth or residence. There are 3 exceptions to this. The first is that for employment to office in a religious or denominational institution, for example, a temple, the person can be of that particular religion or that particular religious denomination. The second exception is that state can make reservations in appointments in favor of backward class of citizens or in favor of SCs and STs. So this is again part of our affirmative action. We can make reservations for SCs, STs and SCBCs, and this power again comes from Article 16 in matters of employment. The last exception is that the Parliament can make law prescribing residency requirements within a state or union territory for appointment to any office under the government of that state or union territory, or for appointment to a local or other authority within that particular state or union territory. So if you are looking for a job in a particular state or union territory, the government can very well impose residency restrictions. Other than that, no other form of discrimination is allowed. Now, the last two articles, Articles 17 and 18, within this subset of right to equality clauses of our constitution, talk about two very pertinent problems and facts which existed before our independence. As you might be aware, we had the practice, or the pratha as they call in Hindi, of untouchability. Article 17 says that untouchability or chuachut is abolished and it forbids its practice in every form. Article 18, which is the last of the right to equality clauses, abolishes all titles like that of Rai Bahadur other than that of an academic or military nature. So you can have academic titles like doctor or military titles like lieutenant general, but other than these category of titles, you cannot have any other title. We do not want to create classes of citizens, and we do not want any discrimination on the basis of your status. Now, these being the equality clauses, we now move our discussion to the freedoms. Now, we all talk about freedoms. I have the freedom to do this, I have the freedom to do that. What exactly are these freedoms? Our freedoms, which are present in Articles 19 to 22, they enshrine the core concept of civil liberties. We had the liberty to do certain things, and these are essential for our development as human beings. Article 19 is the most important clause here. You might have heard of it if you have been reading the news or listening to the news. Now, there are six different kinds of freedoms enumerated in Article 19. And mind you, they all come with reasonable restrictions, because fundamental rights, if you remember, I told you in the beginning, are not absolute. They are limited by certain restrictions. So the very first freedom is the freedom of speech and expression. You can say anything that you want to say, but this is subject to reasonable restrictions in the interest of sovereignty and integrity of India, security of the state, friendly relations with other foreign states, public order, decency, morality, or in relation to the law of contempt of court, defamation, or incitement to an offense. You cannot say that which is immoral. You cannot say that which leads to contempt of court. You cannot defame another person. You cannot incite the public to commit a crime. You cannot say anything against the sovereignty and integrity of India. But beyond these reasonable restrictions, you can say whatever you want to say, including make fair criticisms of government policies. That is allowed. You have the freedom to do that. Now, the other freedoms are, which are perhaps not as important as the freedom to speech and expression. Now, these are the freedom to assemble peacefully and without arms, subject to the condition that you can assemble peacefully and without arms as long as you are not harming the sovereignty and integrity of India, or you are not disrupting the public order. The third freedom is to form associations and unions. We also have the freedom to move freely throughout the territory of India, to reside and settle in any part of India, to practice any profession or to carry on any occupation, trade or business. And we also have in other articles like Article 21 and 22, other subsets of the freedom clauses. We will come to that later. The six freedoms of Article 19 that I have just enumerated, mind you, dear students, they all come with reasonable restrictions, some of which I have enumerated in this particular lecture. Mind you, dear students, please bear in mind that your freedoms are not absolute, and as I discussed, there are certain reasonable restrictions which are imposed on the enjoyment of each one of them. Moving on to Article 20, which is also part of your fundamental freedoms. Now, this article lays down fundamental principles of criminal justice essential for any civilized nation. It lays down three rules, which can be described as, number one, the ex post facto law, which means that no one can be convicted for an act that was not an offense on the day that particular act was done. Second, double jeopardy, which means that no one can be prosecuted and punished for the same offense more than once. You commit a crime once, you get punished for it once. And lastly, right against self-incrimination, which means that no accused can be compelled to be a witness against oneself. Now, we come to Article 21. Which is a very interesting clause, and I would say it is the most profound single sentence which is found in your constitution. It merely says that no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to a procedure established by law. In a sense, this is your right to life clause. But this has been interpreted by the Supreme Court and by other high courts to include right to clean air, right to clean water, right to clean environment, right to health, and numerous other basic rights which are not specifically listed in the Constitution. And the courts have said that right to life means something more than mere animal existence. Everything which makes your human life worth living is included within the right to life. And we also have an Article 21A within this subset of freedoms. Now, this article has been inserted by the 86th Constitutional Amendment, which came about in 2002. This Article 21A says that children of the age of 6 to 14 years are to be provided with free and compulsory education by the state. It is the responsibility of the state to ensure that children between the age of 6 to 14 years get free and compulsory education. It is very important for the future of our country. And lastly, in this subset, we have Article 22, which provides for protection against arrest and detention in certain cases. It merely says that no one can be arrested without being told of the grounds of arrest. And if somebody is arrested, they have to be produced before the magistrate within 24 hours of arrest. No one can be detained in custody for more than 24 hours without authority of the magistrate. And lastly, the arrested person has the right to defend himself or herself through a lawyer of his or her own choice. Now, this Article 22, these provisions, they do not apply to two categories of people. Number one, those who are enemy aliens, and number two, those persons who are detained under preventive detention laws. Now, preventive detention over here refers to detention of a person to prevent that person from committing a crime. So you are apprehending a person beforehand in the expectation that if not apprehended, that person is going to go and commit a crime. But this preventive detention is limited for a period of 3 months, after which the review of the detention itself has to be there by an advisory board. Now, we move on to the right against exploitation clauses. There are two articles in this subset. Article 23, which says that human trafficking and all other forms of forced labor are prohibited. And Article 24, which says that children below the age of 14 years shall not be employed to work in the factories or mines, nor shall they engage in hazardous employment for the simple reason that these children are too young to work. They should rather spend their life, their time studying and playing. Now, we move on to something which is extremely important for the secular fabric of our country, and these are your freedom of religion clauses, which are essentially from Articles 25 to 28. Now, Article 25 merely says that subject to public order, morality and health, all persons, citizens, non-citizens, they are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and the right to freely profess, practice, and propagate religion. So all of you have freedom of religion. You can practice any religion of your choice, and there is no pressure on you to practice or profess a particular religion. But the state can regulate economic, financial, political, and other secular activities associated with religion. Article 26 says that religious denominations, they have the right to establish institutions for religious and charitable purposes, and they can manage their own affairs in the matter of religion without interference by the state. They can own and acquire movable and immovable property and administer such properties. Article 27 says, and it is an extremely important clause, no person shall be compelled to pay taxes whose proceeds are used for payment of expenses for promotion or maintenance of any particular religion or religious denomination. It means that your tax money cannot be used to propagate or promote or maintain any particular religion. The matters of religion and the matters of taxation are absolutely separate. And Article 28 is also important. It's the last of the freedom of religion clauses, and it says that religious instruction shall not be imparted in any educational institution wholly maintained out of state funds. And no person attending any educational institution recognized by the state or receiving money out of state funds shall be required to take part in any religious instruction imparted in any such institution. Nor shall such a person be required to take part in any religious worship in any such institution. So the state institutions or state funded institutions will not impart religious instructions, and even in minority institutions or any other educational institutions where such instructions are being imparted, you cannot be compelled against your choice to take part in religious activities. This is very important for maintaining the secular fabric of our country and for giving citizens a choice, the choice to do what they want to do, because religion, after all, is a very personal matter. It is not a public matter and definitely not a state matter. Now, we come to our cultural and educational rights. There are two clauses, Article 29, which says that the sections of citizens residing in India and having a distinct language, script, or culture of their own shall have the right to conserve the same. And no citizen can be denied admission into any educational institutions maintained by the state or receiving aid out of state funds on grounds only of their religion, race, caste, language, or any of them. You have to understand, dear students, that we have a diversity of religions and of cultures, of languages in this country. There are communities, there are tribes which are living, for example, in the Northeast, which have their own cultural traditions, their own languages, their own distinct prathas, as they call it in Hindi. And each one of these sections of citizens in India have the right to maintain their own culture, their own language, their own script. They can conserve that. This is what the right to culture and educational freedoms is all about. Now, Article 30 says that religious or linguistic minorities have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. And state is not going to discriminate any such institution while granting aid to such educational institutions. And now we come to the last and one of the most important fundamental rights that we have, which is the right to constitutional remedies. This has been called the heart and soul of the Indian Constitution by Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. And this right to constitutional remedies is nothing but a remedy for violation of fundamental rights. So what do you do when any of these rights, the five category of rights that I just told you about, is violated? You have to have some redressal mechanism. You go to the court. In this case, you go for constitutional remedies under Article 32 of our Constitution, which empowers the Supreme Court to enforce or protect your fundamental rights. Why? Whom do you need protection against? Well, you need the protection against the state, because the state can make laws which infringe your fundamental rights, or the state can impose unreasonable restrictions on your enjoyment of fundamental rights. And any such unreasonable restrictions or any such laws which infringe upon the fundamental rights of the citizens can be set aside by the Supreme Court under Article 32. Under Article 226, High Courts have a similar power. But in fact, the power of High Courts to issue writs is actually wider than the power of the Supreme Court, because the writ jurisdiction of High Courts can be exercised not just in cases of violation or for the enforcement of fundamental rights, but for any other purpose. So the ambit of Article 226 is wider than Article 32. Now, I'll briefly take you to the five categories of writs that we have. We have the writ of habeas corpus. I'm sure in another units you must have studied about these. Habeas corpus merely means to produce the bodies of a person. Now, in cases of unlawful arrest, any person has to be brought before the court. The second writ is of mandamus, which means we command. It is an order to any authority by the court to perform their function. The third writ is of prohibition. It is an order to a lower court or a lower authority to cease from doing that which it cannot do or to stop doing the unlawful. The fourth writ is quo warranto, which means by what authority or warrant. It requires the officer to whom it is issued to show what authority they have to exercise a power or to hold an office. The last of the five writs is that of certiorari. It means to be more fully informed. It is an order to a lower court to deliver its record in a case so that the higher court can review it. Now, lastly, we come to our subset of fundamental duties. As you know, with great power comes great responsibilities, and rights always come with duties. You cannot enjoy your rights, your freedoms, if you do not perform your duties, because rights and duties are generally complementary to each other. Lastly, dear students, we come to fundamental duties. As you know, with great power comes great responsibility, and rights without duties are nothing, because rights and duties are complementary to each other. You can only truly enjoy your rights if you perform your duties. Now, what are these fundamental duties? Well, we have borrowed our fundamental duties from USSR. They are present in part 4A of our constitution, which comprises of Article 51A. These duties were inserted by the 42nd Constitutional Amendment in 1976 and were originally 10 in number. The 11th duty was added later in 2002. All these fundamental duties are non-justiciable in the sense that if somebody is not performing their fundamental duty, then you cannot drag that person or that citizen to the court. So what are these duties? These are very simple duties that we owe to our country as responsible citizens. And these duties are that first of all, we have to abide by our constitution, respect its ideals, respect our constitutional institutions, the national flag and the national anthem. We have to cherish and follow the noble ideals which inspired our national struggle for freedom. Third, we have to uphold and protect the sovereignty, unity and integrity of India. This is our sacred duty as citizens. Number four, we have to defend the country and render national service when called upon to do so. Number five, we have to promote harmony and the spirit of common brotherhood amongst all people of India, transcending religious, linguistic and regional or sectional diversities. And we have to renounce practices derogatory to the dignity of women. We have to become responsible human beings. We must value and preserve the rich heritage of our composite culture. We must protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife, and to have compassion for living creatures. And this, my dear students, is extremely important. If you are living in any major city, you would have known about the menace of pollution. We have to protect this earth, our environment. This is all that we have. And you cannot buy clean air and clean water with any amount of money. we have to develop scientific temper, humanism, and the spirit of inquiry and reform. Please do not be led by dogma. Think rationally, and rational choices should guide you. This is what this duty tells you to do. We also have the duty to safeguard public property, to abjure violence, to strive towards excellence in all spheres of individual and collective activity so that the nation constantly rises to higher levels of endeavor and achievement. And the last of the duties is that parents or guardians have a duty to provide for education to their children, to their wards, between the age of 6 to 14 years. Now, of course, we have a fundamental right for education for children between 6 to 14 years. Now, the essence of all these fundamental rights and duties, the discussion that we had, is to make you responsible citizens. You have to perform your duties and you have to enjoy your rights. These are rights which are available to you because you are human beings. These are some very important freedoms that the Constitution has given to you. This is what protects every individual against the collective might of the state. We expect you to be rational and to protect these freedoms, these fundamental rights, your liberties, your voice, your freedoms, your rights are worth protecting and worth fighting for, because this is the only defense you have against the state. This is the only defense an individual has against a society. We do not have the rule of majority or the rule of minority. We have the rule of constitution. And the essence of that lies in protecting our fundamental rights and performing our duties. Thank you, dear students.